Thank you, sir, for very liberal compliments. And I'm extremely thankful to Dr. Ranjit Kumar Singh for organizing a seminar of this nature. So I'm thankful to IASR, the whole team at SIFS, and the chairpersons of the present conference, Lieutenant General Arun Sahni, Dr. A. Nagaratna, who happens to be a very old friend and colleague in the data protection domain. I think we started this career in data protection. I keep fledgling into lots of careers, so this is one of them. So we have gone through this whole exercise of pre-Justice Sri Krishna, pre-GDPR, and then post-Sri Krishna, JPC, and all of us know where we are as we stand today. And Prince Bunalia, so he's also been doing human service in the field of cybersecurity, more so as a practitioner and a hands-on, and think much more than what we are putting into the trade. So I'll just put my slide on for my convenience and convenience of... Can you see?
Yes, sir. It's visible, sir.
Okay. So this is where we are, and this is how I get into the lecture mode. So once I've done the basic introduction, now I'll restrict myself only to data protection and privacy and will not be getting into the wider domain of cybersecurity unless I'm forced to in a couple of areas where that connect is so direct and so conspicuous that I'll not be able to hold myself. And as the Lieutenant General Sahni said, that we are getting fed of the virtual and we want to get offline. The reality is virtual is real. Let's accept it. Virtual is real and virtual will remain real at least for our lives and even beyond. So that is where we come from. That is where we intend to go. And there'll be some amount of offline stuff which will be coming in between, but our life will be regulated, controlled, decided by the virtual world, by the organizations who run the internet, by the IT behemoths, by the government who want to get into this field for interests better known to them and all of us know as to what it is. And yesterday I was chairing a session on ransomware in Pawan Dukal's conference, and the harsh reality is that ransomware is literally taking over the world. And we are not in a position. One second. This not moving the PPT. Let's try again. Okay. Give me half a minute. Yeah, no, it's fine. Okay. So the harsh reality is, even with the nature of collaboration, which US has been talking of recently, the harsh reality is that ransomware is one animal which we don't understand, and we are generally not trying to create the wherewithal and the capability to understand. There's a couple of lectures I've given on data protection earlier, and I still believe that data protection is a myth, given where we are, given the situational analysis of where the citizens are position today. I personally feel that data protection is a myth. And as we go further, this will be elaborated when we get into different areas in which we are working, where the world has come from, where the world intends to go. And the question today, when we're talking about navigation, this is what we have to navigate, that we have lost our data. Can we resurrect data? Can we resurrect data? Is the single most important question which faces the citizens, governments, and the whole civil fraternity across the face of this earth. Now, this is one daily post. I think most of you would be aware of the fact that I write a daily post and I've been writing it for last 1,888 days without a break. So one of these posts, I think I wrote at the time of GDPR. So all compliances of governments and EU are met with and the situation remains the same, which means the situation remains as bleak. Why these audit reports are not in the public domain? Audit reports of the IT behemoths and lots of companies which impact our life in a manner which is completely unimaginable. It has to be legally mandated. So we have been talking about data from the point of the view of the citizens. At the back end, what is happening inside the IT behemoths, inside those companies who are literally controlling every single piece of data globally and making trillions of dollars out of it, I don't think we have been able to put any guidelines in that particular arena, and I personally feel might be we don't even have the capability to do that. The audit norms have to be laid. Who is auditing the source code and the algorithms? We talk about processing. But who is auditing the source code and the algorithm, and who is competent legally and technically to certify algorithms, what algorithms are being used and for what purpose, and that no other can be used. And this is a very important thing. No other can be used. Well, he is my role model, and why I put his picture for today's, but this particular lecture is primarily for the reason that we are in a time of a very multidisciplinary existence, and unless we have the innovator's capability and the creativity, it will be extremely difficult to navigate the minefield of data misuse, surveillance, covert, overt, automatic collection of data, ubiquitous collection of data, hardware, software, literally anything and everything, which we get into. So I come from a background. First, I come from a background of postgraduation in history from St. Stephen's College, Delhi, then in customs, then in police, governance, and finally, I got into this technology bandwagon. So this has been for my first and my most major creation of an ERP solution with around 2.5 million lines of coding, 522 screens, if I remember correctly, 417 reports, and a wide area network across Karnataka, operating at 1637 locations, and working on a data center of my creation, which is on private cloud and been running successfully for last 13 years, and it's going strong. So we come to what data is. We have been talking about data, but we don't know what data is. What do we call data? Information, data, anything which comes across us. Now we have started calling data. What is this data? Data is a set of values of subjects with respect to qualitative and quantitative variables. So if you understand the qualitative and quantitative variables, then you also understand what is being collected, in which manner it is being collected, and what for what purposes it can be used. So before your algorithms playing into this whole game, we had lots of statistical analysis, and that statistical analysis primarily deals with what we called as a transient data. We don't with the latent data. And once we use the transient data, then we are convinced of the fact that there's nothing left in it, which means we have our pie charts, we have our bar diagram, we have our spikes, and that is the way we have been using data so far. We will not getting into the detailing of the data, but data is measured, collected, and reported and analyzed. This is where the strength of the data comes from. Data has been there since times immemorial. Why today we are talking of data? Because today data has become an asset on which we live, survive, we operate, and literally our whole existence is on data. And the most important fact about the data is that unlike all the assets which you have controlled through human existence, data is not with the owner. So let's be very clear about the fact that data is not with the owner, and primarily on that count, this whole issue of data protection, data processing, making money out of data, data brokers, everything comes into existence. So, and everything today, your video is a data, the data about data is a data. So literally your digital footprint is your final footprint. Your physical existence is secondary to your digital existence. And any collection of data can give the person, the government, or the private enterprise, literally anything and everything to connect, correlate, and predict about it. So whose data, who used it, and for what purpose? These are the basic questions. What changed the very concept of data? The very concept of data got changed because everything has become data, and the only way we can manifest our existence, or anyway, somebody can understand our existence, is data, and only data. So that is where we are. So that is the value of data. Data has become the new oil. It is much more than oil. It is a totally different asset class, which I don't think we have been able to visualize and even imagine of. And lo and behold, with blockchain technology, the Internet of Information is slowly being transformed into Internet of Value. And that is the crux of data revolution. And as we move further, data will become more and more important. So whatever we understood of data, even in the internet world today, is radically different. So what I call as the data 2.0 is personally identifiable data, personal data, personal sensitive data, metadata, big data, and the business of data. And the business of data is very difficult to understand. And as far as we remain distant from understanding the business of data, more so the regulatory agencies the lawmakers and people who matter in governance of this whole world, I think our response, our reaction, and our capability to enact will remain at a very superficial, very flimsy level. Latent data, we have not been utilizing. Latent data is only being utilized by IT behemoths and big companies who realize the utility of their data. And they collect data in the very same manner as it would be required for the business and professional purposes. And they are making huge money out of it. Say for a company like Facebook, which has WhatsApp and Instagram also under its fold, I think we are data coolies for them. So we keep collecting data for them and they make money out of their data. Transient data is the data which we think of, which we talk of, and which you utilize on a regular basis. So whether it's by default or design, security is never by design. So we try to put a infrastructure on whatever is already created. And the whole infrastructure, the IT architecture, the internet architecture has not been created for the purposes of controlling data. It is created for the purpose of ease of passage of data, the communication, the processing, the utility, ease of business, ease of commerce. So it has been created, and over the last, I think, a decade or so, for social interaction as well. How that social interaction on the social media has led to a huge accumulation of unassailable power, which emanates out of data. And then also unassailable power by what amount of money you have been able to make out of this data company. And every company today is a data company. So we should never get into this whole concept of which company is dealing with data, which company is not dealing with data. Every company deals with data. It's very difficult to differentiate that this is personal data and this is not personal data. And that we will be like most of our drug-related cases. So we finally catch those consumers or those small peddlers. Beyond that, we don't get into your Golden Crescent and the Golden Triangle and the mafia zones and Afghanistan opium, which actually control billions and billion dollars of not only money which comes out of opium and drugs, but also control large number of all sorts of enterprises. I'll not go and enumerate those, but large number of all those enterprises. So decision-making, operations, and monetization. So the three things which are coming out of data. How much of this data is used for government decision-making? That is another question. See, data protection does not mean that we just take personally identifiable data and we say that we are done away with it. If you start with only personally identifiable data and then go and keep tinkering over and over again, we will remain the where we are. And whatever GDPR has delivered so far, I think we can take analysis of it, and then we will realize as to the manner in which the enactment of law, the enforcement of law, and the capability of the enforcement agencies to get into the business enterprises, even the government, is critical to data protection. Exchange creates ease and value. That is what data is all about. So it is the datafication of mankind. So we are in the process of datafication of mankind. So from money to movement to sentiments to emotions, they say Facebook can tell you about your personality with some 64 likes and all that to a reasonable level. And by the time it reaches some 300 odd feedbacks, likes, or whatever you call it, they will be able to tell you more than even what your spouse knows. So this is the whole history of data. So data is the new oil and data is the new electricity, for the simple reason that if we talk about general purpose technologies, the general purpose technologies from the fire wheel till today, which has given you a whole concept of changing the life or elevating our comfort level to a totally different level. In the very same manner, data provides you once in a lifetime opportunity to elevate your existence financially, socially, security-wise, in whichever manner to a totally different level. You can call it the way you talk about Industry 4.0 or Industrial Revolution 4.0. I think we are also in a stage of data 2.0 or 4.0, whichever way you describe. And our understanding or incapability of understanding the utility and value of data has brought us where we are. So ownership is surreal. It is not a real ownership. And all of us know, mostly in the crowd which I am in, so what is de jure and what is de facto? So who is the de jure owner and who is the de facto owner? And we have absolutely nothing by which we can claim ownership of the data, which we are trying to protect. And if it does not get protected, You put an enactment in place and it does not get protected, what do you do? And only when you are impacted, then only you can go for a legal recourse. Do you know you are impacted? If you don't know you are impacted, then how do you go for a legal recourse? What happened in 2016 presidential election in the US? What happened in Brexit? Your Cambridge Analytica, Facebook, sordid saga. Facebook says, no data has been given. Fiduciary rights which we are talking about, processing rights which we are talking about, even the congressional rights of bringing in Mark Zuckerberg and the like to make them accountable has not yielded any results. So let's realize how strong our adversary is, and there's been a complete votary of people in US after the Patriot Act. So who say, why is privacy required? It is not required because you have not done anything wrong, but that is not the issue. Privacy allows each human being to be left alone in the core, which is inviolable. So you cannot exist without privacy. And if you cannot exist without privacy in the age of data, I think without data protection, the privacy cannot come into the picture. And Supreme Court of India has already given a judgment that privacy is a fundamental right. But how do we enforce the right to privacy, or the fundamental right to privacy, with the enactment of laws, with the enactment of regulatory provisions, with the enactment of oversight, with the enactment of supervisory controls, with the enactment of enforcement mechanisms or creation of enforcement mechanisms? So that is what we intend to do. And if somebody feels that it is something which you can do by a simple act, as we did in the Indian Information Technology Act, and it will transform the world which we live in, that is not going to happen, because it is not just data which you are dealing. You're dealing with lives of people in wide and varied ways and in complete manifestations which we cannot imagine of. So this has been the history of data. You start from Julian Assange, you go to Edward Snowden. So there's also a group of people who, besides the enterprises, besides the the business enterprises and besides the government, are interested in bringing data to the open public domain. They feel that data has to be free, it has to be completely democratized, and it should not remain either with the business enterprises or with the governments or the intelligence agencies the way it is being handled now. So you have Julian Assange, you have Edward Snowden, you have Edward Snowden, you have Cambridge Analytica, he was the whistleblower, Christopher Weil, and we have Bradley Manning of the US Armed Forces, who finally came out in the open and declared whatever he did, and bringing the National Security Agency and lots of other agency into disrepute. So 2013, this came into the picture, and this was a time when data came to the world center stage. Data came to the world center stage. This is after which you had the Patriot Act. When you started talking about intercepting data, when you started talking about that data through which you can obstruct terrorism, the creation of Department of Homeland Security is supposedly the biggest administrative integration exercise in the history of mankind ever. And with the Patriot Act, the citizens, they were transformed into suspects. Our IT behemoths, they have transformed customers or users into products. And our social media world and the social media companies have transformed user into addicts. So this is where we are. And there's a very clear-cut, this expansion of this Patriot Act. You can be very, very, very naive not to understand what is behind it. So uniting and strengthening America by providing appropriate tools required to intercept and obstruct terrorism of 2001. So if you know this background, you will understand as to where you are. The governments also need to understand, the lawmakers and the framers and the JPCs and justices who come together, they have to understand. And there is a technicality behind it. And that technicality is moved or propelled or made to move by the business model. You would have heard of the documentary called The Social Dilemma. And you also would have heard of a Facebook whistleblower, a lady, who has been telling whatever is happening there. So that is the challenge which we face. If we bring down the challenge and if we don't appreciate the challenge, I think the data protection can remain just a myth, and we keep talking about it and nothing great is going to happen. So it is the age of ubiquitous surveillance. Internet, military, internet complex, and not less important is the corporate servants. And if all these people come together, we can understand where we stand as citizens, where we stand as users, our clients, customers, whatever you call it. So there's a surveillance which is going on over and over again, the name of variety of things, by name of security, by name of business, by giving you a better user experience. There are a variety of ways where surreptitiously the surveillance is being done for their interest and not for our interest. Till today, nobody has told me what data belongs to me on Google. It is not that I have to go and cry. You are making a business out of me. You are duty bound to give me as to what data of mine remains is with Google and for what purposes it is being used. Whether there is a government law regulation or not, there's a different story altogether. When you take the consent everywhere, it is your bounded duty that you will tell me as to what you're doing with that. So it is covered, automatic, and it is all pervasive. It is ubiquitous. This is how the whole thing operates on encryption, on backdoors, on revolving doors, on compromised servers. This whole encryption game had a backdoor to NSA in the year 2000-2001. It was a very neat encrypted mechanism or an encryption level and tool, but it had a backdoor. If it has a backdoor, then there's absolutely nothing left. So fear trumps privacy. So this is what we have been talking about, and whose privacy? We have the Apple story also, when the Apple was in a fight with FBI. It was the San Bernardino case. 14 people were killed and 22 were injured. And the phone of the accused, which was an iPhone 5C, that was in question. And finally, Apple did not provide the wherewithal of getting that particular information. And it was done via media manner. So one way... who was asking for this permission, man? Yeah, so whose privacy is it? Now we have to decide. If Apple decides privacy, then it's a different story. If government of US decides privacy, it's a different story. If FBI decides privacy, if there are no regulations, no rules, then you fight it in the court of law. And court will keep interpreting till the time cows come home, and our privacy will remain where it is. And even in a terrorist act and a terrorist crime, we will not be allowed to get into the data which is required at that particular point in time. So data manipulation is name of the game. That you can call in whichever term you feel like, but it is frankly data manipulation. And the Facebook Cambridge Analytica story had a huge amount of role to play in US elections 2016, in Brexit, and in variety of ways all across the face of this earth. What do they call it as a data-driven campaign? The power of big data and psychographics in the electoral process. They were able to change minds. Data is not only that what you are doing with my data in the sense whether you're using data or not using data. You are using my data, and that whole study was conducted by Cambridge. So on Cambridge campus, Cambridge Analytica has created this whole thing. They went into a survey, they analyzed the whole thing, they get into friends, like, dislikes, whatever that whole paraphernalia. And finally, they were able to do whatever they did. So this is where we are. We will not get into the detailing of it, but it clearly says this is a request for any document relating to investigations possibly undertaken since 2014 by ICO concerning companies called Cambridge Analytica and ACL Group. And their response is, we have performed a thorough search of our record and confirm we do not hold any information that falls in the scope of your request. And today the situation is that the law enforcement agencies have to go to these companies and they have to beg. It is not only individuals. It is the law enforcement agencies, even countries like India. There might be another 150, 70, 80 countries where these people will be not entertaining at all. So it is a lip service by these guys for data protection. So primarily what has happened, whether it is in the government or with a private enterprise or with agencies which are via media in between. So this is the story. The fence is eating the crop. When the fence is eating the crop, what do we do? The data creating crunching machine. So all these companies have started with the basic intention, or might be in their early years. They realize that data is the main asset which they have. And on that, they started working at the data creating crunching machine. I think once there was an experiment in Washington, D.C. So two phones were shut. One, I think the SIM card was taken away. Another was the power was shut down. And it went, they went around for nearly 10 miles across Washington, D.C. for 8 hours or 10 hours. And finally, when they came back, they switched off the phone, and the other phone they put in the SIM card, and they allowed the phone to function. Within 5 minutes, every single piece of information was sent to the Google servers. And there were some 138 data points on phones which were not active at that particular point in time, which were transferred to Google servers. What they do with that, I think it is left to your and my imagination. We'll never be able to know as to what is actually happening. But we all know that they are growing in strength from $500, $600, $700 billion and even beyond. So nobody knows the rules of the game. They have not declared the rules of the game. We don't know the rules of the game. And governments are incapable to take out the rules of the game. And variety of the rules of these games are algorithms. If you put even a company like McKinsey today, I don't think they'll be able to fathom out as to how those algorithms operate and give us a complete picture and a roadmap as to how to control these companies. User experience, so which I've been talking about, but products we are. And that is the reality, is the ultimate socialism in a capitalist world. And that is the ultimate socialism, that everybody's data, whether it is the speaker, Nancy Pelosi is there, or it is anybody, they have literally left nobody in this world. So it is ultimate socialism in a capitalist world. Data is there up for sale, whether it is dark net or it is being processed in companies in whichever manner. Privacy cannot be a trade-off or convenience, and that is where we are. So getting hacked is the new normal. Now, this is the whole story. Where is the data? 97% of the Fortune 500 companies have been hacked. And the other 3%, we don't know that they have been hacked. So that is the whole story. So one side, data we are dealing with, personally identifiable data. And I'm not restricting myself to only personally identifiable data. And all those ransomware attacks, how much is personally identifiable data? What is not personally identifiable data? I think there is no mechanism, technical, other and otherwise, to tell you as to what amount of personally identifiable data is impacted. This is something like that buffered zone, air gap of a system, which we have been talking about in the case of Israel, the Stuxnet attack. And the air gap did not operate because one single pen drive was left in that campus. Somebody put the pen drive into the system, and lo and behold, everything was compromised. So this ransomware, only recently, this Colonial Pipelines and JBS in Brazil, they have ended up paying $11 million and $5 million respectively in that particular transaction. There are local self-governments who have paid ransom. So we will not get into the ransomware part of it. Suffice to say that our data, which is lying with the government agencies, they can be hacked into, and the ransomware attack can put that whole data on hold. It can be dealt in a manner which we cannot imagine of. So restricting it to a private citizen and his data, which he comes to know for whatever reason, or whatever is provided either by the government or the private enterprise to be his whole world of data protection and privacy, is certainly not correct. We'll not get into the detailing of this thing. It does not serve our purpose for this particular lecture. Can personal data save itself? So today where we are, can personal data save itself? We are talking about how do we navigate the data minefield. Personal data today is not in the position to save itself. So that is the reality of life. And I, as a person, as a professional, I always give things with finality. There might be people who might not like. So that's personally fine. But it certainly will be thought-provoking. And it will take you in a direction and the trajectory which is required in the interest of the citizens. What is the legal guarantee and accountability? You have a Data Protection Act. We have a GDPR. What is the legal guarantee that GDPR takes care of every person's data comprehensively? Does it have the capability and the wherewithal, technical, financial, operational, enforcement, and otherwise? And whose accountability is it? If today that data is taken away, who is accountable for it? I'm accountable for it. The government is accountable for it. Who is accountable for it? The protection, the data protection authority is accountable for it. Who's accountable? It comes up with, laws are made in a very, very supposedly comprehensive manner, which also means that when you get into the nuances of it, you can only battle it out in a court of law. And to battle it out in a court of law, it can be a battle between Government of India and Twitter and Facebook of that nature. You and me will not be in a position to battle it out of the strength of Google or Facebook or whatever. How is it being enforced? The IT behemoths improv. Do we have the consent of the companies who are holding our data? Are they ready to comply to the Indian laws? Are they ready to create together with us a mechanism to control them only? Are they ready to do that? So primarily we are in the stage of forced consent. So from the forced consent to informed consent, right to erasure, when the data is being given to a third party, for what purpose is being given? So I think it is a totally different world altogether, and we are not in a position to understand the complexity thereof. And if we are not able to understand the complexity of that particular game, reaching the destination, which has to go necessarily through this route, how do we reach the destination? And we talk of personal data. The whole IT behemoths or these huge MNCs, their business model is data. Their business model is to extract data. And every single click which you have on Google, I presume, creates 9 or 7 sets of data. Do we know the creation of the data? Do we know the data life cycle? Do we know the processing of data? Do you know the utility of data? Do you know the monetization of data? Do you know what fiduciaries are using that data? There are 1,000 associates of Facebook who have been using the data in 2016, 2017, and all that through those Brexit years and things of that nature. So it is a world held hostage. And the first light we could see was GDPR. GDPR, I think the law got enacted in 2016, and there was a 2-year period before the implementation could start. And 25th of May 2018, this law came into existence. We are not getting into the nitty-gritty of law. We are just trying to say that this is supposedly the gold standard, and whatever wherewithal is required, at least the technical legal level. So that has been provided for in this particular law. How, what impact it has made, what impact it has not made. We are nearly 3.5 years down the line. I think we can make a very successful impact analysis of GDPR, whether it has impacted the citizens in the manner it should, whether the citizens are even aware of it, or we have all the mechanisms inside these private companies to take care of the personally identifiable data above and beyond the legal compliances, wherein just before 25th of May 2018, I think there's a huge quantum of mails which are being thrown to all users. So we have complied to this, you have complied to that, and you give a consent, which means everything is complied with. Let's understand one thing very, very clearly, that this, as much it is a legal issue, or more than what it is a legal issue, it is a technology issue, it is an encryption issue. It is the data flow issue, it is the data creation issue. Why do you create data which is not required by you? Why can't we have a very single, simple format that whatever is the business requirement, only that will be, or the transactional requirement for that particular transaction. And that also should not exist beyond, say, 1 day, 2 day, or whatever. So if you're not able to control this whole data creation, flow mechanism, monetization, this whole game, and these are global elements, these are not national, semi-national elements. A police station today operates in a small jurisdiction. It cannot operate at an international level. Even nation states are a bit too small for these companies. And that is why Zuckerberg and company have been playing around literally with every legislature on the face of this earth. And they literally don't go anywhere. 3 years down the line of GDPR, the gains, the losses, the battle. It is left to you for decide. That will give us our navigational chart or our North Star of the battle in which we are getting into, or which we have already got into, or which we have delayed for reasons best known to us. We cannot put a data protection bill for discussion for three years in whichever manner. There are legalities, there are processes, there are procedures. Certainly, they should be there. That is how democracy functions. But there has to be a timeline. There has to be a purpose. There has to be a delivery mechanism. The gains, the losses, and the battle, it is left to you. So whether it has a teeth or it doesn't have a teeth, I have absolutely no idea. This is what the Indian judges had to talk about. And it was a unanimous judgment with 6 judgments by 9 judgments. I think it would be the only judgment which has a unanimous 9 judge bench. So this is where we are. And after that judgment, where we have reached so far. And huge amount of work was done by Justice B.M. Sri Krishna and the whole team of 9 or 11 members. And they went all around the country. They discussed. And we were at some level of consensus. It was not that it was out of the blue, that the civil society or the citizens were not involved, and that we were cut off from that consultation process. We might have some dissent or some disagreement or some other point of view regarding one or two or a couple of these points or sections proposed for that particular bill. But that is nearly all. The whole generic direction of this bill, at least at the at the legal level, was in the right direction. And after 2-3 years of discussion, going into technical committee, going to JPC and the like, now we are there to ask this question: for whom are the laws enacted? Now this is the question which faces, whether it's for the citizen or it's for the government. So we have to take a call. This law is for whom? Law making today in areas of technology, and areas of technology unfortunately permeate every single activity of our existence, is a game of expertise, is a game of intention, and game of attitude. We need to have all these three things in sync. If we don't have all these three things in sync with the requirement of the citizen, with the controlling, supervision, and auditing capabilities required for these big companies, we are generally for a loss. So, and recently, I think 2 days back, so this has been cleared. I think it will get into the process. It is already in the process of becoming a law. So we have Section 35 exemptions, which is very, very wide-ranging, far-reaching, and it has nearly everything which provides the government to move in the direction it wants, necessary or expedient. So 35 exemptions, Section 35 exemption, whether it will be used as necessary or expedient. And it also says that in our, I think, Puttaswamy case, we talked about just, fair, and proportionate. So there are so many issues of this nature. Sexual 12 processing, the government is exempted out of it. Social media, now they become publishers. So you can imagine the accountability part of it. Non-personal data is also included. Reporting of data breaches is perfectly fine. But after reporting of data breaches in 72 hours, what do you do with that? So it goes further. So where data collected by hardware, so that also becomes a part of it. And data localization. Data localization is fine, but how do we control localization? How we don't have a mirror copy anywhere else for whatever purposes can be used. And, hello.
Mr. Sanjay, we'll have to...
we'll just wind up 2 minutes. Then data protection authority, which is primarily work under the directive of the government. So the task cut out for us is this. It is humongous. We have been talking about it, our experience with the IT Act. Enforcement can be the game changer if we are able to delineate the direction of our enforcement. Privacy was never there. It was never meant to be in the IT world. Can we resurrect is the question. And the first directional change has to be an international law on data. It might be something like a charter of universal charter of human rights. If it cannot be a law because of a variety of other reasons, so issue is beyond nation states. Can we collaborate? So if issue is beyond nation states, the solution also has to be found beyond nation state, because even the best of the law which a country promulgates, there are wide varieties of leeways or escape mechanism which these companies have been taking till today. The track record so far, track record is not good. And the collaboration which you has been talking about, I think it will remain more at the paper level, as been with the Belgrade Convention and things of that nature. Is there no other choice? Certainly there is no other choice. So thanks a lot. You people have been a very great audience, and wish this conference good luck.